Let's get some more on all the late breaking developments. Marc Short is joining us. He's the chief of staff to the Vice President Mike Pence, also a former CNN contributor, former legislative director over at the White House as well. Marc, thanks very much for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me tonight.
All right, let's begin with all the breaking news, and then we'll move on to some of the other issues. On the Mueller report, the chairman you just heard of the House Judiciary Committee, Jerry Nadler, just telling CNN that the attorney general will not commit to releasing the full report. Would it be a mistake for the attorney general to withhold information that isn't classified or sensitive grand jury proceedings?
Well, I haven't read the report, so it's hard for me to second guess the attorney general. I trust his judgment on this. I think the president's weighed in about his preference for as much transparency as possible. But no, I certainly have confidence in the attorney general's decision on that.
As you know, the U.S. intelligence community says the Russians interfered in the 2016 presidential election to help Donald Trump. But now the Mueller report confirms that assessment. But President Trump has never fully accepted that conclusion. I want you to listen to what he said last summer in Helsinki at a summit, right after a summit with Vladimir Putin.
My people came to me, Dan Coats came to me and some others. They said they think it's Russia. I have President Putin. He just said it's not Russia. I will say this. I don't see any reason why it would be.
Now that Robert Mueller has said so in his report, Bill Barr, the attorney general, has accepted that. Are the president and the vice president, and you're the chief of staff for the vice president, finally ready to accept once and for all that the Russians interfered in the 2016 presidential election?
Wolf, I think there's a lot of evidence that Russia's been a malign character in a lot of this, and they've been looking to sow seeds of discord in lots of ways. And so, yeah, I accept that they interfered. But can I just say why I think that a lot of the coverage here has been so deranged for the last couple of years? Because they continue to see new and new stories say, well, what about this? Can accept Russian interference or Russian collusion? And yet never does the media take a step back and say, which president is the one that actually armed the Ukrainians? Was it Trump or was it Obama? It was Trump. Which president actually decided to bomb Syria and in that action actually killed several Russian mercenaries? It was Trump when Obama just said he was going to draw a red line in the sand. Which president pulled out of INF against Russian objections? It was Trump. It was not Obama. Which president has kicked out more diplomats? It was Trump, not Obama. Which president has put more sanctions on? It was Trump. It was not Obama. And just today you saw the president again make statements about Russian interference in Venezuela. This president has stood up to Russia time and again, and yet the media continues to push this notion about Russia collusion, or perhaps even on your network. I saw this weekend when the story broke, CNN was saying, well, then why is he always talking so nicely about Putin? You're not actually looking at the facts of what this administration has done
explain
and
that.
How hard it's been.
Well, while you raise
the
issue,
facts.
Why doesn't the president flatly say what his intelligence community is saying, the director of national intelligence, Dan Coats, says? Why doesn't he simply say, yes, the Russians did it and Putin is wrong?
Well, if look at what he said just simply today about Venezuela. He has again stood up to Russia in much stronger terms than previous administrations have. I think that it's time the media began actually looking at the record on this.
According to this new report on NBC News, and I want you're the chief of staff to the vice president, the relationship between Dan Coats, the director of national intelligence, and the president took a serious blow after that summit in Helsinki with Putin. And NBC says your boss, the vice president, Mike Pence, intervened to prevent Coats from quitting late last year. Do both the president and the vice president have faith in Dan Coats?
Yes, I think that, as you know, the vice president was governor of Indiana. He's worked with Dan Coats for many years and has a personal friendship with him as well. But if the president didn't have confidence in him, there would have been a change. So I think it's clear that the president and vice president have confidence in Dan Coats. And I've seen the reports, but I have nothing to add to them.
All right, let's turn to the Trump administration's new effort to completely repeal Obamacare in the courts. Millions of Americans count on the Affordable Care Act for their health insurance. As you know, take a look at this. 52 million Americans have benefited from the pre-existing condition protections under Obamacare. 12.7 million gained coverage under the Medicaid expansion part of the Affordable Care Act. 11.4 million Americans bought coverage on the Affordable Care Act exchanges for 2019. So if this effort in the court succeeds to repeal Obamacare without a replacement, what happens to those many millions of people?
Well, let's step back and get to how we got to this point for a second, Wolf. The reality is that the Obama administration argued the individual mandate is not a tax, and Justice Roberts determined it was, and therefore the law could stand. As you know, when we repealed the individual mandate, that actually penalizes those earning $50,000 and less the most. More than 58% of those who are paying the penalty are earning under $50,000. And we were able to repeal that so Americans didn't have to pay that tax anymore. Therefore, you created a second set of court proceedings. And in Texas, they ruled that now the individual mandate is no longer required, then the whole law unfolds. It's our position that Obamacare has not been positive for America. There were estimates there would be 24 million people on Obamacare by 2018, and in fact, the reality was it was about a third of that that had signed up on the exchanges. Prices increased for individual premiums over 100% from 2013 to 2017. They've actually begun to stabilize, Wolf, because this administration now has more plans on the Obamacare exchanges.
But what happens, Mark, excuse me for interrupting, but what happens if it goes through the courts? The president has now instructed the Justice Department to go ahead and support this these court decisions to completely get rid of all of Obamacare. What if that happens and there's no replacement that has passed the House, passed the Senate, and been signed into law by the president?
The president will be putting forward plans this year that we hope to introduce into Congress, Wolf, but the reality is that the court decision is likely not until the summer of 2020 by the time it would reach the Supreme Court. We don't know how they would rule. The president has said repeatedly he would not sign any law unless it protected pre-existing conditions. What you'll see as far as Republican plans will be offered will provide, again, insurance across state lines, will be able to look to reduce premiums and provide more freedom. And we're happy to have the debate with Democrats as they continue to march towards socialized medicine.
The decision that was just made this week to go ahead and support these judicial rulings against Obamacare clearly has divided a lot of Republicans. You know this. Your boss, the vice president, apparently, according to a lot of reports, raised some concerns about what would be the political impact of this move, at least right now. According to Axios, the House Minority Leader, Kevin McCarthy, told the president, this decision at this point makes no sense because Democrats won big in the 2018 elections. They took over the majority in the House of Representatives by running on health care. Do you worry Democrats will take advantage of this current fight over health care and help them in 2020?
No, Wolf, quite the contrary. I think the Republicans won elections in 2012 and 2014, in 2014 and 2010, and in actuality in 2016 on promises to repeal and replace Obamacare. So again, we welcome a political debate about whether or not Americans want more choice, more freedom, lower premiums, or a march towards socialized medicine. So yes, we welcome that debate. I would correct one thing, and that the vice president's had no distance from the president on this. I saw the Chiron at CNN, I saw the Axios report, and I just would like to correct the record that the president's been, the vice president's been fully supportive of the president's position.
Just to be precise, Mark, the vice president did not express any concerns at all to the president about the potential political fallout from issuing this decision right now?
The president has been very supportive. The vice president's been very supportive of the president's determination on this and does not have separation from him.
But you didn't answer the question. Did he express any concerns?
He is not.
He didn't express any concerns about the political ramifications.
The vice president was, if you recall, he was chairman of House Republicans in 2010 when we won landslide elections, 63 Republican House seats on the promises of repealing and replacing Obamacare.
That was then, but look what happened in 2018. The Democrats took the majority in the House of Representatives.
Sure they did.
Many of those Democrats were running on the issue of health care.
Well, I know that there's been sort of, I think, a recreation of what transpired. There's no doubt that Democrats picked up 40 seats. But I think a lot of Americans like divided government. There was a lot of issues in that. I know that they want to push the narrative that it was on health care. But I think the reality is there was a lot of issues in the 2018 election.
Republicans couldn't manage to repeal and replace Obamacare when your party, the Republican Party, controlled both houses of Congress. Why would it be any easier now that the Democrats control the House?
I'm not sure it would be right now, Wolf. I think the reality is that going back to our last efforts, we were not able to muster any support from Democrats despite our efforts to try to, I think, provide lower premiums and more choices for patients. But as we look forward to the next coming years, I think the question will be what happens in the courts. And if the court decisions are such, then hopefully there would be a bipartisan effort to say, look, we need to fix this and come forward. Right now, I think you're probably right. There isn't much incentive for Democrats to work with Republicans.
You know, a lot of people are going to be very nervous about potentially losing their health care, their health insurance, if this current judicial battle gets to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court decides to side with the president, and there's no replacement in the works for that. You guys got a lot of work going on over there. Marc Short, congratulations on your new job over at the White House. We'll stay in close touch, and you're always welcome to join us here in the Situation Room.
Thank you, Will. Thanks for having me.
Marc Short is the Chief of Staff for the Vice President, Mike Pence.